I was in my house and I heard that the World Trade Center was just hit by some kind of a bomb, something from somewhere crashed into the World Trade Center. They didn't seem to know why or what happened, who caused it, what was the reason for it. All they knew was that something crashed into the World Trade Center. They didn't even say it was necessarily a plane, so I didn't know if it was a guy with a big stick or an old Jew going for a walk or some of my sister-in-law who was shopping and happened to crash into the lobby. I didn't know what it was. I said to myself, it can't be possible that there's something real tragic here, that a real bomb is going to hit a building in New York. I said, that sounds as ridiculous. That sounds like the president getting somebody a job. It sounded almost impossible. So I couldn't conceive of it. So I was desperate to find out what actually happened. Then a few minutes later, I hear that a plane crashed into the building. So I said, who was driving it? There must be a very bad pilot. Somebody forgot to take a lesson and just flew a plane without permission or something. I said, how could a guy go that wrong? I heard of planes crashing, but not into a building. So then I said to myself, what could it be? Then little by little, the story came out that some kind of a terrorist organization actually flew a plane into the World Trade Center. I said, wait a second, the terrorists are that powerful that the most unbelievably strong country in the history of the world could be bombed by terrorists? Terrorists, a guy had a picture of them as suicide bombs, that people walk around with something in their belt and they could blow up a coffee shop in Israel, or they could blow up an entrance to a building in some place in a foreign country, but not here. They had the knife to come here, the people with nothing but beards and schmatters, and they have no power and they have no major equipment. How do you compete with the United States of America, a guy walking around who was just sent with some schmutter to put in his pants? I couldn't imagine that someplace, somewhere, so there's somebody, a terrorist, has the kind of power to find a plane and nobody would notice it. America, with all of its genius technology, wouldn't see a plane coming or wouldn't know from where. And with all the consolidation of the systems at the airports and all of our technology to sense and see anything that's coming from any place in the world, and foreign countries with all their power can't do this to America, and somehow a terrorist without a country, or just a person who walks around with a schmutter, could suddenly fly a plane into a building and we wouldn't even notice it, we wouldn't stop it, we wouldn't find it, it sounded inconceivable to me. But then the story came out that that's exactly what happened. What sounded inconceivable and impossible, what sounded like an inconceivable idea, all of a sudden actually happened. It's like somebody telling me that a guy with a bag of peanuts could somehow blow up the Empire State Building. I couldn't imagine it. Then the story came out that all this unimaginable thing actually happened. That no matter how powerful we are, we didn't have any system to actually catch a plane like that before it bombed the building. And while you think of it as impossible, somehow it's very simple. This impossible thing was really very simple. We just didn't protect ourselves from it because everybody assumed it's impossible. They were just as ignorant as I am. The heads of the armies of America and the whole military system of this country was totally unprepared for this kind of a possibility. To change the mentality of everybody in the United States. People in general are selfish, and people in general are basically no good. They have elements and sides of them that are somehow decency in human beings, but in general, people are basically no good. Because when people see a man on the floor, almost everybody walks right past him. He might be dying, they don't care, they just don't want to get involved. Everybody remembers the story about the girl in Queens, I forgot her name, who was being shot at, and guns were going off about the guy was shooting at her or killing her, and everybody knew she was going to get killed, but nobody bothered to call the police and nobody bothered to do anything about it because everybody's more fearful of getting involved than saving anybody's life. which goes to show that people are basically more concerned about protecting themselves from being inconvenienced, from having to spend maybe an extra half an hour as a witness or something, than to save a person's life. It's not worth it to them.
So what changed?
Because people are basically no good. When you see people in the street, and no matter what kind of a problem anybody has, nobody cares. You could be in a theater, and all of a sudden a guy is choking or about to die. Everybody's just thinking, don't interrupt the picture, don't interrupt the play, and get him the hell out of here. I'm not interested. Nobody wants to get involved. So the point is that all of a sudden, after this happened, everybody felt, oh my God, we're really in trouble as a country. We better stick together and protect ourselves and protect each other. Otherwise, who knows what could happen to us? All of a sudden, we felt too vulnerable to be unconcerned about each other. We became too frightened not to be protective of each other, because we couldn't imagine everybody feel so secure in this country and so comfortable that nothing could happen to them. All of a sudden, they found out that something could happen to anybody, and all of a sudden, you could be attacked and you might get killed. So. If this is what could happen to me, we better stick together as a country and work together and do something to take care of ourselves, and not only ourselves, but to take care of each other, because the next day you might be the one in trouble, and you might be the one that's flying out of a window, and you might be the one who's about to get killed, and you might need the help of your fellow men, and you better be protective and concerned about your fellow men, otherwise you wouldn't be concerned about you. So all of a sudden, when people think they're in trouble, they start to care for each other for their own selfish purposes, and that selfish purpose made everybody all of a sudden nice to each other and act much more civilized and compassionate and concerned about each other. And we became a whole different mentality took place in this country. I think after that, comedians told jokes, but only an idiot of a comedian would think that they would find anything comical or funny about a horrible tragedy like this. I think the boundaries of good taste exist in any intelligent human being. You don't talk to a priest the same way you talk to a hooker, because then you have a sense of taste, of propriety about who you're dealing with and how to deal with them in accordance to what you see in the other human being. You don't talk to everybody the same way. If you were suddenly introduced to the President of the United States, you wouldn't sound the same as you were suddenly introduced to a pimp. You would have a different kind of approach to the subject. In the middle of a party, when you meet one of your friends, you fear with your speech, then you talk to a person you talk to as a stranger because you're concerned and worried about how you're approaching them. At a time like this, it doesn't take a genius to know that the jokes about that situation are not exactly funny, and only a moron would have to be told not to tell jokes about it or to find anything humorous. And there's sick comedy among young comedians all the time who laugh and do all kinds of comedy about death and destruction of human life. Sadistic humor among young comedians is very popular today, and you can hear it in all the comedy clubs. But anybody, even among those kids, who tell ordinarily sick jokes about starvation and human misery and everything else, I don't think they were stupid enough to tell jokes about this situation, because people were too concerned about each other at that time to be able to tolerate that kind of humor. I didn't refer to it at all in my show, because I knew that people come to see a comedian to escape from the misery of the preoccupation with this situation. There was an undercurrent of misery in everybody's mind. Everybody felt lucky that through the grace of God it could have been them, and they felt lucky that they're the ones that didn't get killed. At the same time, they felt very guilty about the ones who did, because they felt that they should make any kind of a sacrifice to show their concern and their compassion for the relatives and friends and family of the people who did lose their lives. So this involvement was in everybody's mind, and I thought that people come to see a comedian for exactly that reason, to escape from the misery of and that preoccupation that they're suffering with. That's in the back of everybody's mind. So to get away from it and to have a little vacation from that kind of misery, you go to see a comedian so to go into another world and change the subject. So I never made any reference at all, because I felt that would be stupid of me to bring them back to that kind of misery when I'm trying to be funny, when they came to escape from it.
After 9/11, how long did it take before you were back on doing the show?
About 3-4 days. I don't remember exactly, but it was at least 3-4 days. I felt it's inappropriate to tell jokes the next day, and nobody would be in the mood to laugh the next day. But after 3 or 4 days, I felt, and after thinking and being involved with the misery of the experience, people by now wanted to escape from it.
You're a comedian.
Right.
Your job is to make people laugh. Clearly, everybody was in mourning a couple of days after 9/11. How do you go back on stage yourself when you're feeling that way in front of these people?
Because I felt the need to escape myself. I felt the need to have some kind of an escape from the constant preoccupation I had with the subject. And I felt like telling a joke. And I knew that people will want to laugh, and they laughed probably louder, and they did. They laughed twice as loud as they usually laugh, because they were saying to themselves, thank God I could get away from it for a minute.
I spoke to someone else who was in another Broadway show at the same time, and they came back after, I think, two nights. They were back on Thursday night. And they said they had a 1,400-seat theater. I think they were doing the music mass. And they came back, and there were 200 people in the audience. What was that first show like? Was it filled? Was there fewer people there? How long did it take?
It was packed. If it was just comedy, it was packed. If it was a serious show or a musical, it was not doing so great, because it's not enough of an escape. There's too much human misery in a story kind of a show. If people wanted to get away from a story about somebody neglected, rejected, suffering, maybe dying, all kinds of an integrated story which takes your involvement, didn't interest anybody at that time. They didn't want to be involved and emotionally attached to something. They wanted to get out of the way from their emotions of any negative thought, of any heavy kind of a problem. There's problems in all these pictures. Every movie, basically a story of a problem and how people struggle with it, and finally at the end of the picture, either die from it or finally get out of it. But it's all a story of human misery at one point or another. People wanted to get away from stories with miserable experiences involved in it. But if a guy is just telling straight jokes, they said, thank God, let's go. It took probably a month or two at least. So it was a couple of months before I started to tell Bin Laden jokes and jokes of that type. Because I felt it's far enough away so that you could laugh at a reminder of even a remote reminder of the situation. I stayed away from for a long time, for at least a couple of months. Then I started to notice that you could make references not directly to the situation, which is still too heavy to handle, but you could tell jokes about the terrorists in general. I'd started to do jokes about suicide bombers. I said they killed somebody because they think they're going to get 72 virgins. I said, how come there's still so many virgins if there's so many suicide bombers? Could they still be virgins? I can't believe it. And besides, what kind of a gift is it to have 72 virgins? You ever try to make love to a virgin? You ever see what you have to go through? I'd rather have one hooker than 72 virgins.